Welcome to lecture 20. So in the previous lecture we have seen a 2D FEM code which is developed to solve a two dimensional magnetostatic problem. In that FEM code we have used the mesh that has been generated manually, okay, but that kind of mesh is easily applicable for rectangular geometries where the discretization is also uniform, but in case of electrical machines most of the geometries will have circular boundaries. So in that case that algorithm will be difficult to mesh such kind of geometries. So for that case we have to use some meshing softwares which are available online. So one such kind of freeware to mesh a 2D geometry of any shape is Gmesh, okay. So you can download Gmesh. You can download Gmesh software using the link that is given in this slide, okay, and preferably you download this version of software because the mesh data available that comes out of this software is more easy to understand. Now in this lecture we are going to solve the same 2D geometry using the mesh generated by using Gmesh, okay. So this geometry we have seen in the previous lecture already. So first in this lecture we will go to the Gmesh software interface and then we will draw this geometry, we will mesh it and we will extract the mesh data in terms of PET matrices, and then we use the same PET matrices in the same code that we have seen in the previous lecture with very few modifications. Only in this lecture we are going to focus only on the modifications of the code in the previous lecture, okay. So now first we will go to the Gmesh software. You can directly download from that link and it will come in the form of a zip file, okay, like this. So if you extract that zip file you can open that folder. Here there is no need of installation also. Directly you double click on the application of this icon. This is the application icon. So you directly double click on this, you can open the Gmesh interface, okay. Now here on the left hand side you can see three different things. One, first is geometry. So under this you have different entities to draw the geometry, okay. So here these are the entities that are used to draw the geometry, okay. So geometry, according to these list of entities we can draw geometry either by using circles, rectangles, circular arcs and so on. But here in this lecture we are going to draw the geometry by using points and straight lines, okay. So here why? Because most of the electrical machines the geometries are basically of circular arcs and they are not complete circles and complete rectangles, is it not? If you imagine how a slot looks, it is like this. It is not a complete arc also. It is not a complete circle, it is an arc. So better we draw geometry using nodes and join by straight lines, that is a better way. So here also I am going to do the same thing. So here in this slide you can see these are the coordinates of the 8 nodes. Here the 2 rectangles are formed by 8 points, is it not? Here the 2 rectangles are formed by 8 nodes. So first we are going to place these nodes in the geometry, okay. So here first you click on point, okay. Once this window comes here you enter all the coordinates, okay. So our coordinates are 0 0 first coordinate is 0 0, and length of the outer boundary is 0.1. you have seen that. So I am changing my x coordinate as 0.1, okay. And then height of the rectangle is 0.1 again, so I am changing y coordinate as 0.1, and now I am closing the rectangle with 0, 0.1, okay. So we have formed the outer nodes of the outer rectangle, okay. Now we are going to form the inner nodes of the inner rectangle, okay. So here you just enter 0.303 and 0.03, and length is 40 mm, is it not? So you have to
increase the x coordinate by 0.04.
okay, and then height is 0.04. so
increase y coordinate to 0.07,
and then close the rectangle by placing the fourth node. Okay, now you have placed the nodes. Now you have to frame the geometry by closing these nodes using straight lines, is it not? It is a rectangle, na? So it will have straight lines. So here I want to highlight one thing in case of Gmesh. So as we have discussed in the previous lecture, we make use of the mesh information to form the to apply the boundary conditions, is it not? So we need to know the something called as global edge number. That is like on which there will be a label for this edge, complete edge. So that label we need to know to explore that condition. In Gmesh, the way you draw, in the sequence you draw, the numbering will be assigned in the same sequence. Okay. Similarly, for subdomain numbers also, in the sequence you assign the subdomain number, in the same sequence that global node that subdomain number will be assigned. Okay. So that advantage we can explore. So to see what are all the global edge numbers and global subdomain numbers, so you have to right click here. Okay, go to all geometry options. In visibility tab, you check the line labels, surface label. Okay, so now as you draw the straight line, so I am drawing the first vertical line like this. Okay, here you can see for this edge, one has been assigned. Okay, is it clear? Similarly, if I draw this as second, this will get the second. Similarly, third. Similarly, fourth. So to avoid confusion while you draw the geometry, you assign the outer boundary, where in general we apply, most of the cases we apply A is equal to 0 with 1, 2, 3, 4. First you draw those edges, so that part of the code where you assign the boundary conditions will remain same for any geometry. Okay, now after that you draw the straight lines for the inner rectangle. Okay, now after this we need to assign the subdomain number, is it not? So subdomain numbers, here there are two subdomains. Okay, the first subdomain is in between the outer rectangle and the inner rectangle. So this outer rectangle and inner rectangle form the boundary of the air subdomain. Okay, so to define the plane surface, you click on the two boundaries. You click plane surface here and you select the two boundaries. So these two form the boundaries of the first subdomain. So whatever may be the subdomain subdomain you need to choose, you click the all boundaries in which is bounded for that subdomain, and then you click E. Here you can see press E to end. Here it is written, press E to end. So you click on E, so that will assign the first subdomain number. Here you can see there is 1. Okay, similarly to second the subdomain, click on second subdomain, click on plane surface and select the boundary. So for the inner rectangle, which is rectangular conductor, the boundary is only this rectangle, so I am choosing only this one, and then click on E, that will select you the second subdomain. Okay, after this, so now we have assigned the subdomains also. Now we need to mesh this geometry. So here geometry thing is completed. Now go to mesh. So this is a 2D geometry, is it not? Here you can mesh a 3D geometry also. This is a 2D geometry, so click on 2D. So mesh has generated, but this is a very coarse mesh. Now you need to refine this mesh, is it not? So click on refine mesh by splitting. So like this, if you keep on refining, the mesh will get refined automatically. Okay, but in this mesh there is a problem. Here you can see, for these elements, these triangles are obtuse angle triangle. So it is advisable to have equilateral triangles to get an accurate result. So you need to avoid this kind of
obtuse angle.
So for that, you need to change the algorithm. So there will be a default algorithm for G mesh, which can mesh the geometry. So you need to change the algorithm of meshing. So for that, you right click on this space, go to all mesh options. Here in general, you have 2D algorithm. Are you getting? Here there is automatically selected. In that place, you select this algorithm. This is Delaunay algorithm. Okay. So after selecting this, you click on 2D. So you can see the mesh shape has changed. Now more or less all the elements are equilateral triangle. They are equally spaced almost. Okay. So and the two subregions and the elements in two subregions are with different colors. Okay. Now here I want to highlight one point. So in case of electrostatics, you no need to mesh the geometry that correspond to conductor, because E field is zero there. So you need no need to calculate the potential in that region. Okay. So for in that case, to mesh that region, you don't select the boundary, you don't select its plane surface. Like the way we selected this conductor, you don't select that conductor. So by doing that, it will not mesh that region. Okay, that's how you can reduce your mesh sizes. Okay, now we have generated the mesh. After generating the mesh, we need to export this mesh into Scilab code. Okay, first of all we need to save this mesh data. So here under the mesh tree, you have save option. You click on save. Here you can see where it has been saved. Okay, so it has saved here app data roaming. So first, actually you need to save this geometry file in a folder, so that you get the mesh data in one file. Now you just go to that folder. Okay, here you can see example1.msh file. So mesh data will get saved in the msh file. So you just right click on this file and then open with notepad. Okay,
you will get the complete information about the generated mesh in this file. This file contains two sets of information. The first set of information will be saved under section notes. Under section notes, you can see there is a number 270. This 270 corresponds to total number of nodes in the mesh, and the rest of the information corresponds to the coordinates of the nodes in the mesh. So here what you have to do is you have to copy the information that corresponds to the coordinates in a text file, and you have to save it as p.txt in a folder where you will save the code, Scilab code. So you open a notepad file and copy the information and save it with p.txt file. Now the second set of information will be saved under section elements, and this section contains three sets of data. The first set of data corresponds to the global nodes that are placed to draw the geometry, and the second set of information corresponds to edges that are on the boundaries of the geometry, and the third set of information corresponds to triangles in the mesh, which is nothing but the connectivity matrix that we have seen in the previous lecture. So here the question that arises is, since the three set of data are saved under the same section, how to distinguish these three sets of data? So here you can see the data that corresponds to the nodes will have 6 columns, the data that corresponds to edges will have 7 columns, and the data that corresponds to triangles will have 8 columns. Okay, so what you have to do is, here we will save only the information that corresponds to edges and triangles. Why? Because the information that corresponds to nodes will have no use in our code. So first you have to copy the information that corresponds to edges in a notepad file, like the way we have done for the nodes, and you have to save it as e.txt file in the same folder where the p file is saved. Similarly, you have to copy the information that corresponds to triangles in a notepad file, and then you have to save it in the same folder where the p and e files are saved. So with this we have completed the task of extracting the mesh information in terms of three matrices, that are P, E and T. And now we will see how to use this information in the Scilab code to solve a 2D magnetostatic problem.
Now going into the slides, so this we have seen already. Now here this CLC clear all, you know what it is. Now the next part, so now the next part is this pfscanf mat. So this command is will read the text files, this command will read the data in text files into a matrix in Scilab. Okay, so there this p.txt we have saved already. Okay, so here in this case this fscanf will take out all the information that is in the p.txt file into this p matrix. Okay, so what is the information that is in p.txt is this. Okay, here the first column is node numbers. Okay, second column is x coordinates of all the nodes, third column is y coordinates of all the nodes, and fourth column is z coordinates. Okay, as this is a 2D problem, the z coordinates are by default 0. Okay, so what are all the things that we needed here? So we have to take only the things that we need, only x and y coordinates, is it not? So here I am taking only two and second and third columns, and I am updating my p matrix with that data, and I am taking a transpose of it so that it will be in line with the form of matrices that we have seen in the previous lectures. Okay, so after this operation my p matrix will be like this. So the column numbers of these p matrices, of this pre matrix, is nothing but node numbers. Okay, and the size of this p matrix is 2 by number of nodes. Now similarly e matrix, so e.txt file we will read into the e matrix, and in this e text file we have, as I have discussed earlier, there are 7 columns, is it not? Of these 7 columns, first is element number. This element number means combination of all the 3 set of data. Okay, this has this numbering has of no use. Okay, and the and these 3 also gmesh generated thing, this is also has no use in this case. Okay, only thing that we use here is the last 3 columns. Okay, the this column, this fifth column is global edge number. So this information we will be used to assign the boundary conditions. Okay, so for the first edge, you may remember while we are drawing the geometry, the first edge got assigned to the vertical. So that first edge, similarly second, for the second edge this will be changed to 2, similarly for the third edge, and this and starting node number will be placed in the sixth column, and the ending node number will be placed in the seventh column. So after this operation, so we are taking only fifth to seventh columns, and we are transposing it so that we will get an E matrix of this kind. So the first row of this updated E matrix will have global edge number, second row will have starting node number, third row will have ending node number. Okay, so finally the E matrix size is 3 by number of nodes. And then T matrix, similar to the other two matrices, we can get the data of T matrix and we can save it in a matrix of whose name is T. And then as similar to E matrix, the first 4 columns are of no use, we are going to use only the columns 5 to 8. Okay, that's why we are taking columns 5 to 8 and we are taking making a transpose. Okay, so that our T updated T matrix will be of this kind. Okay, so here the
fifth column,
this first row, which is nothing but this column, this first row denotes the subdomain number. Okay, and this subdomain number will be used to assign the material properties and assign the source conditions. And first, second and second, third and fourth rows
contain
the global node numbers of each element. Are you getting? Is it clear? So the first, the second row, third row and fourth row will have the global node numbers of each element, and the element number is nothing but column number. This column corresponds to first element, this column corresponds to second element, this column corresponds to third element. That's why the column number corresponds to element number. Okay, now the size of, finally the size of T matrix will be 4 by number of elements. Okay, so up to here the meshing and taking that mesh into the code we have seen. So this part is completely different from the code that we have seen in the previous lecture. So from here the next part will is same up to calculation of element coefficient matrices. Only next thing what we need to change is assigning the source conditions, is it not? So in the previous lecture, if you remember, we have assigned the source conditions by verifying whether its centroid is inside that rectangular region or not, is it not? So in this lecture, in this code, we are not using that logic, we are just checking its subdomain number. So for every element, as we have seen earlier, the first row corresponds to subdomain number. We are checking whether the subdomain number is true or not. If it is true, we are assigning the source. If not, we are not assigning the source. If not, since there are only two, one is rectangular conductor, second is air. So we are assigning only to the rectangular conductor only. So this part of the code will be changed for that code that we have seen in the previous lecture. Similarly, the next step that we need to change is assigning the boundary conditions. So boundary, in the previous lecture we have seen boundary conditions are assigned node wise, is it not? We have done a bookkeeping of all the node numbers and we have made a logic for which all the bottom edge nodes, top edge nodes, like that we have done. But here with the help of Gmesh, we know the global edge numbers, this 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, this we can remember, as we have drawn the geometry and we have assigned that outer 4 edges are the main boundaries, outer boundaries where A should be assigned. So that we will check whether the global edge number of each edge is 1 or 2 or 3 or 4, and we will assign the boundary conditions. This part of the code is same. There you will see that we are applying boundary condition to one node at a time, because we are assigning node wise. Here each edge will have two nodes. Okay, so that's why we are assigning boundary conditions to two nodes at a time. Okay, that's why there you have seen 3 steps, here you will see 6 steps. Okay, now after this, plotting has to be changed. So the surf and contour plots, that those commands are applicable only for rectangular grids. Okay, you cannot use those commands to plot for triangular mesh. Okay, so that's why we need to form a rectangular grid first. So we got the solution already. And then you after getting the solution, you discretize the geometry into a rectangular grid and you calculate the potential at each and every node of this rectangular grid using the solution that you have obtained. So you frame a grid and it will have many number of points like this. Each node you check in which element it is present, and then you calculate the potential of that grid node. Using the three potentials of the three node. Okay, so that you can calculate the potential of this complete rectangular grid. Okay, this is the logic that we are going to follow to plot the potentials in this case. So here, how can you know whether a point is inside a triangle, inside a triangle or not? So if a point is inside the triangle, okay, if let's say a point is inside a triangle, one point can be always be inside one triangle only, is it not? So if a point is inside the triangle, then you frame three triangles, okay, with this node and the triangle. Like this is that unknown potential node. You form triangle with nodes 1 and 3 of the triangle, that is delta 1. Form a triangle with nodes 1 and 2, that is delta 2. Form a triangle with nodes 2 and 3, that is delta 3. Okay. If the sum of these three triangles is equal to the area of this big triangle, then the node is inside the triangle. If not, then that area will be more than the area of big triangle. That you can visualize directly using these two figures, is it not? So here, to calculate the potentials on this grid for plotting purpose, we are going to do the same logic. So first, we are going to discretize in the same fashion that we have done in the previous code, okay. And then for each element, we are checking, we are taking the difference. Delta 1, delta 2, delta 3, we will be calculating using that node informations, and then we are calculating the difference. Why we are taking difference is, numerically, this, since this is a computing software, sometimes that may not be numerically equal. That delta 1 plus delta 2 plus delta 3 may not be numerically equal to delta. So that is why we are calculating the difference between sum of that area and area of the triangle, and we are storing it in difference matrix. Okay. Once we will store it for all the elements, after that we will take the minimum difference triangle, for the triangle for which the difference is minimum, we will take the triangle number. Okay. So now we got to know in which triangle that node is present. Okay. Now using this formula, okay, A inside an element can be approximated as A plus BX plus CY. This is our initial step of formulation. Okay. Using this, we will calculate, and using the potentials at the three nodes, using this formula and potentials at the three nodes, we will calculate ABC by just by inverting. This step also we have seen previously. Okay. Now once this is done, we will get ABC values. You just substitute X and Y coordinates, you can get the potential at that point. Okay. So this part of the code is nothing but this logic. Okay. Here this M matrix corresponds to this matrix, 1 x1 y1, 1 x2 y2, 1 x3 y3. So here x1 y1 is the x coordinate and y coordinates are stored in P matrix. First row of P matrix is x coordinate, and second row of P matrix is y coordinate, and global node number 1 is second row of T matrix. So like that, you can calculate, you can get the information of x1 y1, x2 y2, x3 y3. Form this matrix like this, take inverse of M into pot potential, you will get ABC values, and I am storing those values in ABC matrix. So this will be a 3 by 1 matrix, in which ABC 1 corresponds to A, ABC 2 corresponds to B, ABC 3 corresponds to C. Okay. And substitute the x and y coordinates, you will get the potential at that corresponding grid point. Okay. So you can, now you can plot that using the same surface command. So this logic of plotting by using a rectangular grid on a triangular mesh is common to all the codes. This logic will be there in all the Scilab codes. Okay. Whereas in case of MATLAB, there is an inbuilt PDE toolbox, where that toolbox also generates same PET matrices. Using that PDE toolbox commands, which is called as PDE plot, you can plot that directly. But in case of Scilab, we don't have such kind of command. That's why we are using this logic to plot. Okay. Similarly, you can plot a contour plot also for this. Okay. Thank you.